It's too late now. We're going.
That's all right. That's fine. No, let me get rid of this real quick for you guys. Get my strop out of there. Okay, so today we're talking about pasta. Now, homemade pasta is very easy to do and very fast. As a matter of fact, most of the time when I make homemade pasta, I put the water on to boil and I've got the noodles made and cut before the water is even ready. So that's how much faster it can be. And of course, they cook in like less than half the time, like 3 or 4 minutes tops, right? And fresh pasta means that you can control what goes in there. A lot of people will try to tell you that you have to have special flour, that you have to do things a certain way. You really, really don't. Most of the time, we don't have time for that crap. Most people don't have the skill. And you know, most people can't even tell the difference anyway. All these guys that use these extra porous boards and make the well in the middle and draw the stuff into the eggs and all that, most people can't tell the difference between that stuff anyway. So I'm going to show you a really good way to make a really quick homemade pasta. We're going to cut some fettuccine here on our machine here. And I'm going to show you just really, really how simple this recipe can be. Now, when you measure your flour, I'm just using plain white AP flour here. You could use whole wheat flour. Yes, you can use semolina if you want to, but semolina is really only necessary when you're doing the extruded pastas, when you're like through the machine extruder, right? And you're doing stuff like macaroni and stuff like that that needs to be pushed out and it needs to be dried, otherwise it's just going to do that. But these rolled pastas do white flour and wheat flour and buckwheat flour, stuff like that, just fine. So when you measure your when you measure your flour, just give it a good shake because you don't want it to be all packed in there, right? You want it fairly loose. The recipe is extremely easy. It's one egg, 1 tablespoon of oil, 1 teaspoon of salt for every cup of flour. 1, 1, 1, 1, right? It's that simple. So I've got my first cup. I'm going to make 2 cups. We've got a big family. There we go. So 2 cups right there. Perfect. We'll use that again in a minute. I say 1 teaspoon per, you know what, pinch. It's not rocket surgery, right? Just put a little salt in there. Now I need to mix up my eggs and get my oil. That's one thing I forgot, though. I forgot to get my whip. Where is it? I'll use this one then. I'll just use a fork. That'll be good enough. Okay, so she paused that while I screwed around over there. So I just get my eggs here. You really don't have to mix up your eggs. I've done this plenty of times without it. But I'm feeling in a egg mixy kind of mood. So I just break my yolks there. Before I do that, I'm going to add my oil to them. And really, if you're like super health conscious and you don't need the calories, you don't really have to put the oil in there. There we go. Yeah. I'll just give it a little mix. There we go. This is a simple egg fettuccine. Bring this guy over here and put him on the machine. Use the paddle. All right, raise that up, start that going. And very, very, very carefully dump in your eggs.
Now, clearly for the people that do not have a KitchenAid, I'm gonna presume the next best method is stirring.
Yeah, sure. You could do this with your hands. You can make the well in the middle of the table and bring the stuff in, right? Now I'm going to raise this up just a little. Now, a lot of times you're going to find that this is a little bit dry. So I'm going to add water a tablespoon at a time. I'll start with 2. That's what it took yesterday. Well, maybe it took 3. I don't remember. So, if you're going to err on one side, err on the moist side. You don't really want it to be dry. If you get it accidentally a little bit too moist, that's better. So I'm going to stop this because even though you can see it's crumbly, it's how well it holds together. So you got to pick it up and squeeze it. And if it holds together in a dough, and it does, it's absolutely perfect. So that was one tablespoon per.
Whoa.
But that's just with the humidity that I have in the kitchen right now with my flour and all that, right? You may take, you know, one tablespoon, or you may take a tablespoon and a half, or 2.5 tablespoons. It really just depends. So don't take this as the golden recipe, right? So now just get all this stuff out of here. Now I don't mind building up a little bit of gluten as well. I've got a little bit of water in here, so I will build up a little bit of gluten as I need this. And a little gluten will help firm up your pasta, and it'll make it, it'll give it that lovely resistance and that chewiness that you want in pasta, right? But you don't want to build it up to the point where it's like bread when you push it down and it comes all the way back, right? You don't want it to fight you. So I'm just kneading this a little bit right here. There we go. I'll dump this out the rest of the way. I do have a little bit of dryness right there, so I'm going to try to fold that in some. There we go. Now, if you do get this too dry, and it looks like this may have turned out to be just a tiny bit too dry, you can easily fix it by just sprinkling a little bit of water on here like this, and then folding it in. There you go, and sprinkling a little bit of water in there and folding that in. There we go. And once this starts to hydrate, it'll get fixed right fine. Now, this is where you can venture away from classical wisdom again. Now, everybody that makes pasta tells you, now, wrap this in plastic and put it in the fridge for at least an hour to chill and relax. Sure, absolutely. If you've got that kind of time, throw it in there. It'll help the dough hydrate, and the dough actually works better on the machine when it's cold. But quite often I'm doing this on the last minute and I don't have that kind of time, right? So we're going to go ahead and press ours now. You can see it's still perfectly malleable. So I am going to look for my scraper, which is right here. I'm going to cut off a piece about that big because this will actually get to be pretty long. Now I'm back to the flour. You really should flour this stuff when you put it on your machine, because it'll stick to the rollers, and when it sticks to the rollers, then the rollers will just rip it. So you've got to knead this in the machine a little. Notice how I'm flattening this a little bit so it'll get through the machine itself, right? Now I've had this machine, I'm years old now. No, I'm 46 now, and I bought this machine when I was about 17, used at a garage sale. And this machine has never faltered once. It's a beautiful little machine. A lot of times in the past, I've been in cooking stores, and I'm like, oh, look at all the new fancy machines. I can get them. A lot of them look almost exactly like this. In fact, this company still makes this exact same pasta machine.
I thought it said right there on the front, Atlas.
This says Atlas, yeah. And it's made in Italy. So I've looked at them many times, but I can't think of a reason why I should replace this one, because they look exactly the same. Now you notice how I fold it and I can put it in the other way now, right? So I'm basically just trying to A, get a good shape out of it, and B, get it to firm up a little bit and become one nice big piece. This is the perfect consistency right now. It's not tacky and it's not dry. It turned out absolutely perfect with that little bit of extra water I put in there. I'm not even needing flour right this second. So this will probably be the last one at this one. There we go. Now, oh, it smells so good. So I'm on number one. Most of the time they tell you, oh, well, go to number two. It's not necessary. You can skip one. I'm going straight to three. And because I'm skipping, I am going to put a little flour on there. Notice how you don't have to kill it. Just dust it like that. A little bit of flour on there. And I'm going to feed this through. Notice how I always bring my hand back under here to catch it. There we go. That's beautiful. The edges are just a little bit rough. So I am going to fold it and turn it sideways. See, now my edges are much smoother. And I'm going to fold it one more time this way, and I'm going to put it back in the same way. This is just me trying to square it off just a little bit.
when I was younger, before I learned how to make pasta, I saw the packaging on the box, right, where they were feeding this perfectly square piece of pasta into the machine, and I couldn't for the life of me figure out how to get that thing so square. I used to stand here forever folding it different ways and everything. So I spent so long trying to figure out different ways to get that to come out perfectly square, and then one day it dawned on me, I bet they cut it. Yeah, well, you know, I wasn't too bright when I was young. Okay, so, and I'm a DBA now, so, you know, I'm not that bright now. All right, so, I'm going to do this one again. Now I'm going to go up to 5. Now, I'm going up to 5. You can do whatever you like, right? But I think 5 is perfect for fettuccine. And if I can get this fed in there, there we go. And this is going to be considerably stiffer. You can put your hand under there like that, right? Give it some nice support.
There you're not go. Pulling it out of there in the least. You're just supporting it.
Yeah, I'm just supporting it. Now, that's a nice long noodle. We are not going for longest noodle contest. So we are going to cut that in half with our cutter right there. There we go. Let me move some of this because I am done. There we go. And now I can take these guys and just support them here on the edge like that. But I do want to flour them one last time. The flour is going to do a couple things for me. It's going to keep them from sticking to the table. And it's going to help dry them out a little bit. I want to dry them just a hair before I cut them. And that's going to really help. And as a matter of fact, I've got a little bit of that water on there from when I was rehydrating the dough. There we go. Some of that over there. Soak up that water. Okay. Now I just set these guys over here on the end. This guy never actually got any. There we go. Set him on the end like that. Cut off another one. And lather, rinse, repeat, right? So I'll let you watch me do this one more, and then I'll go do the last one on my own. Because, you know, repetition and all that. So I'm flattening it out so it'll fit through the rollers.
You've brought it back down to setting 1.
Yeah, I brought it back down to 1.
So while you're doing that, I've got a question.
Sure.
Do you think pasta is worth doing if you don't have one of these machines, if you have to roll it out by hand with a rolling pin?
Rolling it out by hand is very tough. You can't get it even, and a lot of times you're going to end up overworking the dough, meaning you're going to build up so much gluten in there that when you roll it, it's going to keep bouncing back on you. It can be done, right? Because I did it for centuries.
Of course.
Yeah, that's the same one I just sent through. I couldn't remember. This one now. So it's really going to depend on your skill with the rolling pin. That's really all I have to say about that. I've done it a few times in the past, and it is, it sounds better on paper.
Yeah, sure.
Right? Because, I mean, not only the extra work. See, now, sometimes, and this is the perfect example, that you have to squeeze the end to get it to fit into the roller for it to catch. There you go. So I would say that for all practical purposes, if you don't have one of these machines, it's probably not worth it.
Or I believe the KitchenAids, if you've got a KitchenAid, they've got a pasta rolling extension on the front.
A pasta machine, right? Not necessarily this one.
Right. I'm just pointing out that there's another option. Have you ever used one of those?
No, actually. But it looks just like this. It has the roller. It just fits on the front. You just feed it through automatically. But I'll say, now I've gone to setting 3 now, but I will say that, in fact, I lost my train of thought there a second ago, that even without the extra work and the problems with gluten that you may have, getting it even is really hard, and getting it thin enough is really hard. A lot of people look at it, you know, if you're not trained to do it by somebody, they look at the thickness that they've gotten, they're like, wow, that's pretty thin. And they flour it up and then start cutting their noodles, only to turn out and they've got noodles like that thick. And it's like, oh my God, right? So
You've got macaroni that's not hollow.
Yeah. And it's hard to get right because, you know, the evenness is gonna be a really big problem too. You're gonna have noodles that are paper thin on one side,
sure,
and, you know, practically steaks on the other side, right? And I'm already on 5.
So here's another question.
Yes.
You're making fresh pasta. Why make fresh pasta instead of just buying the box stuff?
Well, there are a couple reasons. Number one, fresh pasta, you know what's in it. So you're controlling your ingredients. Number two, there is a difference in taste between fresh pasta and dried pasta.
Yeah, there is.
So you really can't tell the difference. Number three, it takes less time to cook, right? And number four, you get the pasta you want. So, I mean, you've seen me mix basil in with these guys.
Yeah.
You can make spinach pasta, beet pasta. You can make all these different pastas. You can make whole wheat pasta, or you can put in wheat germ. You can do anything you want with all these pastas. This is going to end up being a long one, but I'm going to make it all in one long string just to show you guys that.
Oh, you were going to do that last one off camera.
You can get ridiculous. Sure, I'll do it off camera, and then we'll come back when it's done. How's that?
Sounds good.
Okay, so here we are going for this last little bit. You can see I did make the world's longest noodle. Not really, but so I'm going to lay this out here. I still have to flour it. Now, before I do this, I want to talk about fixing moisture levels, because this is an important part of pasta making. It's not a big deal, but you need to know how to do it. I said earlier that I prefer to have it a little wet than a little dry. That's because if it's a little wet, it's a lot easier to work a little bit of extra flour in there than it is to work a little extra water in there, because it gets all gooey and squishy and you got to work it back in and it gets tacky and all over your hands and all that, right? But here, if it's a little bit wet, you could do what we did when we were feeding it through the different times, right? You could just put flour in there, fold it in half, feed it through, put flour in there, fold it in half, feed it through, and that flour will work through until you get it exactly the way you need it. And you do that exact same thing with water, too. If it's too dry, then just flatten it out with your hands really far, right? Take a water bottle, spritz it with water, or take some and sprinkle some in there, fold it in half, run it through the machine as best you can, right? Flatten it out, fold it in half, keep doing that with water until you get what... But with water, give it a couple minutes to hydrate in between, because you're going to add, when you're adding extra water, you're going to add this much water until it's just the way you need it. And then it's going to fully hydrate, and you're going to kind of, and then you're going to kind of be too watery now, right? You're going to have too much water, and then you're going to have to add flour. So, you know, you have to give it a couple minutes to hydrate. But once this soaks up the water, it soaks up the water, so it's a lot easier. So that's why I prefer. Plus, even if it's a little bit wet, you can still feed it through the machine, and if it's dry, it'll just crumble off in your hands. Go. Flour in these guys. Perfect. Good. This right here. That looks like a good noodle. You know, just as long as you want. Now, you could take these same sheets and use them to make ravioli.
Or lasagna.
You're
parpadelli.
Right.
If
I don't cut these are lasagna, right? If I cut them wide, they're parpadelli and so on. We'll just have some long noodles in there too, huh? Now, to freeze these things, because it's still fresh pasta when it's frozen, and it's still fabulous when it's frozen, right? I've had plenty of fresh pasta that was frozen. So right now, I'm leaving these out here to dry just a little bit. And you could also fully dry these as well. You could lay them flat like this, and now you've got pasta noodles, right? But when I cut these for freezing, I'll leave them out here for 30 minutes to an hour. It really depends on the air and the moisture level in your pasta, right? So they should have a tiny bit of a crust on the outside, just a little bit, but not so much that when I do this, it's going to break off. It should still tear, right? That's going to really help the freezing process, because these things, when you cut them, they're going to want to stick together. And when you freeze them, they're going to want to stick together. So the more of this, the more you can put that little crust on the outside, the less they're going to stick together, because now there's that crust that's going to protect them, right? It's going to keep them from freezing together. And it's going to help separate them when you go cut them into fettuccines as well. It's just that if you wait too long, they'll break off into little pieces down here, and you'll just have little tiny pasta pieces instead, right? So don't wait too long. I could cut these right now, but we've got, we don't have dinner till tonight, so I'm going to cut these probably, judging off of these moisture levels, probably in about half an hour to an hour. I may have to come in here and flip them, right? If you don't want to flip them, you can easily, like, if you've got the back of a chair or something over there that's a wooden chair, you can throw them over the back of a chair. Or if you've got those cup hangers with the cardboard things for the
dry cleaning,
the pants, right? You don't want to put them on wire, because that wire will just sit there and just, it'll just cut right through them and they'll just fall, right? So the weight of these alone will cut them. So I'm going to leave these because I want to cook them tonight, and I want them to be a little bit drier so that they last. But this is the same way that they do pasta when you get fresh pasta in the store, when you get fresh pasta in restaurants. This is exactly the same way they do it. They let it dry for a few minutes usually, and then they cut these things beautifully. And of course, a lot of times they use semolina, but we didn't. And we could make this exact same thing with whole wheat flour or with a mixture, and it would be grand. So when you cook these things, put them in rapidly boiling water. No, you don't have to add oil. Put them in rapidly boiling water for about 3 to 4 minutes. You know how to tell when pasta's done.
What if they don't?
What if they don't? Then maybe we'll have a cooking pasta video, or maybe we'll come back in a little while and film the cooking of it, right? But sky's the limit. This is the basic pasta recipe that you can do in just a few minutes. And, you know, without me teaching it to you, I can get it done in like 5 minutes, 10 minutes with cutting, right? So there you go. That is fresh homemade pasta, uncut as of yet, but I suspect we'll come back and cut it here in just a little while. But it's beautiful. Look at that. Okay, so we've got our pasta ready over there. I'll show you that in a second because we're going to cut them. And I've got my water here. I filled the pot about halfway filled with a couple pinches of salt, probably 2 pinches of salt, about like that. You want to always salt your water for pasta because it gives the pasta some lovely salty flavor, right? The salt doesn't do anything else except, you know, add some enhancement to your pasta, but you'll definitely notice if you don't do it. You see a lot of chefs, a lot of cooking shows even, will talk about how much water you need for your pasta. You need to put it in a great big pot like this. If the pasta needs lots of room to roll around in, it can need lots of room, but it can also do just fine in a little bit of room too. And when you're cooking for a family or when you're cooking for yourself and you got stuff to do, you don't have 45 minutes to 90 minutes for a big pot of water to boil, right? So something like this will probably take 10 minutes to boil. That's not so bad. You can put it on while you're doing something else, right? It's all about time management.
Yeah, you gestured to our large pot down here. I'll give you guys an idea of what he was talking about.
And actually, it can be advantageous to make pasta in a little bit of water as well, because if you're going to make a sauce, then you're going to get a lot of starch cooked out into the water, and you can use that to thicken your sauce with very, very nicely. If you've got a lot of water, you're not going to get as much of that. So actually using a smaller amount of water can be an advantage. So anyway, let's come over here and let's look at our pastas. We've got this. These guys have sat for, what's it been, almost an hour?
Something like that.
Yeah. And you can see they're, well, you can't see it, but you can feel, right, that they're a little bit dry on the outside. But you can see they're still perfectly malleable, right? They're not breaking. But they've just got a little bit of a tiny dryness on the outside. I had to come in here after about 20-25 minutes and flip them over, right? And so this is absolutely perfect. Now, you also notice that they're not even. This is the best one of the bunch, but this one is absolutely horrible. If it bothers you, get a knife, cut them off while they're still nice and moist, and then you'll have perfectly square pasta and you can do something with those ends. But you're just about to cut them into strips and eat them. I mean, who cares, right? If this one is a little bit long, big deal.
This
right?
is home cooking, not show cooking.
Exactly. So anyway, let's go ahead and make these guys. We're going to make fettuccine. So I'll put that there. I'm going to get this ready before the water is done. Now, I stress again, not stress, but I'm going to say again that you really don't have to do this step. You can make the noodles, flatten them, and cut them right after each other. You don't have to wait for them to dry or anything and right into the water. So I did this because I've got the time and I kind of wanted to show you how to do this, right? So anyway, why don't we switch places?
Sure.
There we go. Now I hope that thing will grab. sometimes when they get that crust on there, right, they can be a little bit hard to grab. So you got to just kind of...
Yeah, I'll help you.
Yeah, help me out there just a little. Let me...
There, I felt it catch. Little,
there we go. So now I just reach under here. And look at how, when I dry these, look at how perfectly they separate. They're just gorgeous. Now I'll take those couple little pieces down there.
These were wet and you were cutting them to put right into the water, you would have to cut them and then drape them over the back of a chair or...
No, you don't have to. They'll stick together just a little bit here, as in they won't separate completely like they did here. But if you're going to put them right in the water, then once you put them in the water, just give them a good stirring with a wooden spoon handle or something like this. Put the handle in there and that'll separate them for you. They'll go ahead and separate, but you couldn't, if they were a little bit wetter, so like if they were fresh, if we didn't do this drying thing, and we cut them, you couldn't just leave them sitting here at room temperature on a plate because then they would all melt back in together. But no, for what we're doing, no, they'd be fine. And this one, again, I'm going to have to feed. I have to kind of push it through for it to catch.
See, I tend
to
feed them.
Which is kind of the problem to have.
Yeah, I tend to feed them in ragged side. If I have a ragged side, like you've got a tailing ragged in, that feeds in better.
And look at that, just beautiful. And lay those like that. And this is exactly how you would do this if you were going to freeze them. This is the perfect dryness for them to be frozen. I'm going to kind of push that a little bit. If I can. There we go. Got that fed in there like that. Just reach under here and catch them on the other side. Nice little bundle like that. Well, the reason I tend to do it like this instead of like this is because here I can line up the edge. Whereas if I get it here, I'll get it off and it may go in crooked like that. It may feed in crooked. So at least this way I know that I'm feeding it in straight and I'm not going to get something really funky out of it. There we go. And I've always got to drop at least a couple, don't I?
Of course. Yeah. When in doubt on the cooking show, listen to Sean, not me.
There we go. Fold that, see if I can get it right this time. There we go. Finally did it. There we go. And that water sounds like it's getting really close. There we go. Back to grab. So you can see you can have I'm not going to say a little bit of trouble. It can take a couple seconds for it to grab this pasta when it's dry. But look how much better that is. That's just...
Yeah, I thought of something else we didn't actually list in the reasons to make your own pasta. I think it may actually be cheaper.
I was thinking about it when the camera was off. Not only is it cheaper... But you should know where your food comes from.
Yeah.
What are you going to do in the zombie apocalypse when there aren't people out there making pasta for you and you come across a big stash of somebody's flour and eggs?
Because this is totally going to happen.
Let me check the water.
This should be zombie apocalypse cooking.
Exactly. Okay, so it's not quite ready yet, but it's almost ready. So we're going to pause, and when it's ready, we'll come back. All right, so the water's ready. It's at a full rolling boil. That's one of the rules you can't break. You really do want your water at a full rolling boil. Get this guy. And now how you put the pasta in there is important too. You can't break this rule either. You put the pasta in there.
Is that right? Yeah. As opposed to putting them in one at a time?
Around. I don't know. So I will take this guy right here and I'll stir him around a little bit. Pasta will release a bunch of starch at the beginning. And so it'll stick together. It can stick together. Dried pasta is way worse about sticking together than fresh pasta is, but it's still a good idea to move this around.
And I'm stressed. There is no oil in this water. We don't need that.
No, you don't have to have the oil in the water.
Yeah.
Alton Brown says that the oil merely helps keep the foam down from all the starch coming up. I'll buy that. We never used oil. Now, one of the things that I want to show you, now I'm going to let the temperature get back up rapidly. Now, one of the things that I do want to show you is in restaurants, when we make fresh pasta, we make the pasta all in one batch like this, and then we just heat it up to order. They're not actually cooking fresh pasta to order. So we'll do what we call blanching it, there are a couple different things you do depending on where you are, right? Sometimes they'll partially cook it. So they'll cook this halfway, and then they'll finish cooking it the last minute or 2 minutes when they get the order. That's fine. Or they'll cook it all the way here, and then shock it, like I'm going to show you here in a second, and then they just drop it into boiling water at the end for about 10 or 15 seconds
just to
heat
reheat
it back up.
Yeah.
And then do it. And that's what I'm going to do tonight. So this is going to be dinner tonight, right? We decided on meatball or something or other.
Yeah.
And so this is going to be dinner tonight. So I'm cooking it now, and I'm going to show you to shock it. And see, now I've got my boil. I can take this lid back off now. And I really like to use the butt of a spoon there just to kind of move that stuff around. Look how gorgeous that is. Look at that.
If you spend enough time cooking pasta, you start to get a sense of how done it is just by looking at it. I can look at this and tell it's not done.
Right. It's too white.
Yeah.
Right, or too yellow. But we call it white. Now I'm going to show you when it's done because it'll be mostly cooked and it'll still have this real thin line of dark yellow in there that'll look dry. And that's pretty much done, right? So this will take, I don't know, 3 minutes, 4 minutes, something like that. And it's just beautiful. Look at that. That's gorgeous fettuccine.
Mm-hmm.
That is beautiful. And see this foam right here? That's what they say, that if you've got a lot of pasta and not a lot of water, it will foam up on you, especially if you put a lid on it and leave it there. It'll start to come up and it'll start to boil out. Oats do that too, right?
Yeah.
They do it less if you rinse them off.
Hmm.
I always rinse my oats off and I get a lot less boiling over. But it's the same starch right here that you have that you can use to thicken sauces with, because that starch, you swirl that water around on a ladle and you can see that it's got some viscosity to it, right? Okay, so it's been a couple minutes, so let's go ahead and test one of these and see. So I'll just take this out. I'll pick one of these like that. Blowing out a little bit. Come over here into the heat, or into the light, and you might be able to see it's got that really thin edge right there, but the whole thing feels done to me. So I'm going to take that off. And even if it's not completely done, we are going to heat it up again tonight, right? So, okay. Now, the important thing is to stop the cooking as fast as possible. So I'm going to dump this in here.
Yeah, you've got to have your shock water ready before cooking.
Absolutely, that's a good point. Yeah, don't get your shock water ready now. Now is too late. So I'm going to shake off all that. Look how gorgeous that is.
It's lovely.
And now put it in your shock water. And again, stir that around a little bit to get it moved all around. Now you don't want to soak it in this water because it will soak up some of the water. I want to get it to where, now that that's a little bit more done up, I can use my hand. You just want to stop the cooking. And once it's cold, and it's cold now, but I'm going to leave it for just a few more seconds, then you get rid of it. Now, that doesn't mean that if you have to go answer the phone or use the bathroom or something, a couple minutes isn't going to make a big deal, right? But you don't want to set it in this water until tonight. It'd just be mush.
Right.
So, okay, that's perfect. It is completely cold. Stopped cooking. Because carryover heat, you've got to take carryover heat into account. And if you leave pasta, I dropped an ice and I can't seem to stop stepping on it. And if you drop pasta in a colander like this and just leave it, it's just going to keep cooking and keep cooking and keep cooking, and you're going to have nothing but mush by the time you get it on your plate. Now, if you don't have ice, if you don't have a lot of ice, then just run some really cold water over it and keep flipping it. So run the cold water, flip it, run the cold water, flip it, run the cold water, flip it, until it's cooled down. It doesn't have to be ice. It's better.
It's faster.
It's faster.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So anyway, there you go. If you, a lot of times we'll keep the pasta from sticking together by mixing it with a little olive oil. A little olive oil, just enough to coat it, right? You don't want to swim it, but just enough to coat it. And a lot of times I'll even skip that step and just go with a little cooking spray. Hold it up and mix it around and done. But since I'm going to put this in water again to heat it up, the water's going to loosen it up. So anyway, there you go. That is fresh pasta. And that is how to freeze it. If you freeze it, like I showed you, freeze it on paper. Don't freeze it on metal because there's the moisture in the pasta
may still make it stick to the metal when it freezes. So put it on paper. Then when it's frozen, you can take it out and put it in a nice gallon-sized bag or something, right? And then you got it for the next, I don't know, I've never had pasta last that long, so I don't know how long it lasts in the freezer. But let's say a month.
Sure.
And there you go. That is fresh homemade pasta, and look at that. Gorgeous noodle. Nothing wrong with that at all. Absolutely beautiful. Talk to you guys later.